The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Marshall. Wherever you live in the North American continent, it's hard to imagine that given a reasonably clear day without cloud cover, you won't see an airplane. The great silver birds roaming the sky, sometimes leaving the contrail in their wake, written like a chalk mark on the blue board of the heavens. So safe, so sure, so poised. The actuarial figures prove beyond a shadow of a doubt there is no safer method of transport, despite the myriad things that could go wrong. The only trouble is that when something does...
Flight 113, Transways Airlines, to traffic control. Do you read me? Do you read me? Flight 113 to traffic control. Oh, read me. Read me. Oh, every transceiver can't be out. I'm flight 113 transways to... I can't. Mayday! Mayday!
Our mystery drama, Terror in the Air, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Ian Martin and stars Robert Dryden and Jennifer Harmon. It is sponsored in part by the Florida Orange Growers and Buick Motor Division. I'll be back shortly with Act One. Flight 113, Transways Airlines, took off from Miami, a sleek DC-9 four-engine jet bound for Seattle, Washington, with one set down at Kansas City. The bulk of her manifest was a large charter of meat packers returning from a convention to be dropped off at Kansas City. The small remaining nucleus of passengers was to be increased by only one pickup, 65-year-old Dr. Sam McCall, a man the crew and his fellow passengers were to thank God for the rest of their lives. For Flight 113 was a jinx ship, doomed to a nightmare that is shared by anyone who flies, and against which every precaution is taken so that it won't come true. This is the story of the million-to-one chance when it did, and which began before the Florida takeoff.
This is Flight 113, Transways Airline, post K2. I'm ready to roll as soon as you get me someone to hold my hand.
He's on his way right now from reserve. Hey, what happened to Dave?
Yeah, his father had a coronary. He's pretty hairy, I guess, second time around. Dave took off for the hospital like he was fired from a gun. We're all checked out. I'll get back as soon as Dave's relief gets here. Come. Hi, Franny. Well, what the Sam Hill is that?
Just a moment, Captain. That's our jolly little cargo. 115 slap-happy meat packers on their way home from the convention.
Oh, brother.
Oh, just be glad you don't have to move among them. It's worse than being in Rome. I probably won't be able to sit down for a week.
Well, I'll give them a blast on the horn to tone them down.
Oh, no, they're all right. I can handle them. Just wanted you to know we're loaded and your relief co-pilot is on the way.
Who'd I draw, do you know?
Your lucky day, Captain Thomas. Look what you got.
Doug Fletcher, not you. Now I know we're jinxed.
Sticks and stones will break my bones, but a few breaths coming through that crowd out there and I'm already as high as a kite.
Oh, now, come on, let's cut the comedy. We're 10 minutes late already. Fran, did Charlie check you out on the manifest?
Yes, Captain.
Is he off plane yet?
We're all buttoned up.
Okay. I'll go get that bunch quieted down out there, huh? Hit the no smoke and seat belts.
Right.
Well, nice to have you aboard. Let's earn our pay. This is K-Flight 113 Transways, port K2 to ground control. Request permission to start engines.
You have permission, Captain.
Hit them, Doug. Ready to roll as soon as we get the good word.
Hold it a sec.
Roger. Doug, where'd you?
Oh, at home. Just a little woman. You?
Damn divvies. I never can pass up that chiffon pumpkin pie.
Hey, that's funny. You know, on my way down, I...
Still on the pipe, Transways 113?
Yeah, waiting to roll.
Okay. You're cleared to taxi to runway 5 via Hobo.
Roger. We still have CAVU for the flight?
As far as Kansas City. Ceiling and visibility unlimited.
Thanks. We're on our way.
Have a nice flight.
We aim to please.
That's a load we're carrying we can't lose. Most of them can make it under their own power. Otherwise, it looks like a milk run all the way.
A milk run. The flight where nothing happens. Where everything goes according to the book. And so it did, as far as Kansas City. In spite of the slightly raucous conventioneers who soon passed out quietly to be poured off the plane gently by the stewardesses 2.5 hours later. Waiting to take off again, Captain Thomas and his co-pilot, Doug Fletcher, could have no slightest suspicion that the second half of the flight was to make disaster history.
What are we waiting for, Captain?
Tower clearance.
Anything wrong?
Nope.
Something coming in, I guess. How's the load?
Oh, you could shoot beer back there. Let's see. We have only 32 left.
We didn't pick up anyone here?
Only one, a doctor. Very handy to have aboard.
Now, what does that mean?
Well, just that we have a lady aboard, a married lady who's very pregnant.
Ooh, I hope we don't pick up any rough weather.
Will you knock it off, you two Cassandras? Huh? Now, let's get airborne before you discourage me from the whole flight. This is Flight 113, Transways Airlines. I'm at number one, requesting permission for takeoff.
Acknowledge 113, Transways. Be advised you are now cleared for takeoff.
So, here goes nothing. We're on our way.
Fly happy, Captain.
Only way to go. Thanks, Kansas, and out.
Any takers, Inez?
Yes, but not enough to get the drink cart out. 2 scotches, 1 bourbon, a stinger for the lady in first.
We got that, a stinger? No, I'll take that one to her personally, crabby old biddy.
I can manage.
Oh, I'm going up front anyway, Inez. Maybe the boys want some coffee.
Shall I call them?
No, I need a little exercise. I want to check on our little mother-to-be anyway.
She's pretty near her time, I think.
Oh, not too, I hope. Ever been a midwife?
Of what?
Did you ever deliver a baby?
Oh, no, not me. Either for myself or anyone. I think I would freak out.
Oh, that makes 2 of us. I hope we don't have to find out.
You sure you feel all right, honey?
Will you stop worrying, Fred?
Well, it's just maybe I worry we shouldn't have done this.
It's a little late for that now.
I didn't mean the baby. I mean flying to Seattle.
It's still too late. Everything okay with you two lovebirds?
Oh, sure.
Oh, everything's just fine, stewardess. Make it Fran. We're a small enough group to be a family. Anything I can get you? No, thanks, Fran. How about you, Mr. Pierce?
Oh, no. I'm just fine. It's only Jackie.
The worry ward of the world. About everything. It's just his nature.
Well, this time I really have something to worry about.
Well, not much longer. Only about 1.5 hours to Seattle. I wouldn't want anyone to be embarrassed. I'll hold on until then.
Oh, Jackie.
She's putting you on. He bought a stopwatch so he can time the pains when they start. But don't get me wrong. I love him. That's my exit cue. I've got to deliver the string to someone. Excuse me. Dr. McCall, isn't it?
What? Oh, yes.
I just delivered a drink to your only companion, the lady in the back. Is there anything I can get for you?
For me? No.
seatbelt, Doctor.
It is fastened.
Mind if I sit beside you for a moment?
No, not at all. What is it?
Freak storm. We weren't expecting it, or the seatbelt lights would have been up before now. Are you feeling okay?
Me? Oh, yes, yes. Why?
Well, it's just air pockets. General turbulence. We should be through it in a moment. I just wanted to make sure you didn't feel sick.
I feel sick, all right. But not from this.
I'm sorry. What can I say?
Nothing. What can anyone say? Pete would have been 30 next week. From my angle, that's where life begins. But his ended.
Pete?
My son. First time I ever flew first class in my life, thanks to the Air Force. They're flying Pete's body and the rest of his crew back from Guam. That's where they crashed. His mother is buried in Winochki, you see, where I used to practice. I wanted him to lie with her.
Oh, I'm sorry. I misunderstood about the way you were looking.
That's all right, Miss. If it weren't for the rest of you aboard, I'd just soon cash in my chips right here. Well, it won't be that bad. It's just a pee-wee squall. We're coming out of it. You can go on about your business and forget me.
I guess we did blow right through it. Maybe I should get up and see if the captain and the co-pilot want some coffee.
You get traffic control yet, Doug?
I'm on my third frequency. No response.
Where the devil are they now? Couldn't they have picked up what we just came through on the radar?
Search me. This flight 113 transways to control tower. Do you read me?
Negative. The breaker's out?
No, Captain. I checked.
Well, what do you want, Fran?
What happened? No warning on the fireworks.
Came out of nowhere.
No advance from control?
Yeah, we can't dig them up. Now, do you want anything?
No, just as long as we're off the bump, though. I thought you might like some coffee.
Yeah, heavy on the cream, easy on the sugar. Doug?
No, I skip the coffee. I'm feeling a little off the feed. Hold it.
This is flight 113, Transways Traffic Control. Do you read me?
Anything serious, Doug?
There will be if we don't make contact.
113, Transways.
Oh, forget it. There are so many backup systems beyond the regular frequencies. Emergency, Army, Navy, Sea Rescue, relayed through another plane. No sweat, baby.
I'm worried about you. You don't look so hot.
You should feel my stomach.
This is...
Look, bring me a cola with lots of ice, huh? Wait a minute.
We read you loud and clear. Where the hell have you been? We've been trying to raise you.
Ditto here. Now, where the devil have you been? I'm on emergency backup now, and we are 27,000, cruising speed 485 knots, holding steady, heading 290. You didn't get anything from us on the regular channels.
Negative.
Well, we just came through a freak electrical storm. Didn't you pick that up on radar?
That's why we were trying to reach you. It came in from nowhere. It's a whole front by now.
Well, maybe that's what knocked the radio out. I was thinking of turning back, but maybe I'm better off as we go. What's up ahead?
CAVU on present course. A little storm to the north over the Rockies, but you should bypass it.
Yeah, we better. We got a pregnant lady aboard. I'd like to avoid any more turbulence. Just in case, you want to send us up top?
Stand by till I clear you.
Standing by. Well, looks okay now, except for you, Doug.
What's the matter with me?
You're a little green around the gills. It's that home cooking, or did a few bumps make you air sick?
Oh, no. I don't know what it is. I got the cold sweats. Seeing double. But it wasn't anything I got from Helen. Maybe I should have bypassed Aunt Bibby's.
What do you mean, Aunt Bibby's?
I was trying to tell you before we took off at Florida. I couldn't resist stopping off and having some chiffon pumpkin pie for dessert.
Damn it! That's what I had.
So, you're lucky. It wasn't too rich for you. I don't know. I think I'm going to pass out.
Oh, hold it. Fran.
Yes, Captain.
Fran, I hate to lay this on you, but I've been having the symptoms Doug's complaining about.
Good Lord, Captain.
Oh, this is crazy. It can't be happening. It just couldn't be. But you'd better get back and bring that doctor up here.
Well, I feel like I can hardly move. Look at Doug. He's out. Your doc friend better be for real and get one of us operating. There's going to be nobody left. The land is paved.
I'll get him right away.
Hello. Flight 113, Transways to traffic control. You read me. Damn. Flight 113 to traffic control. Oh, you read me. Read me. Every transceiver can't be out. Flight 113, Transways, read me.
Mayday. The final and ultimate cry for help when an aircraft is disabled or out of control. The last word air traffic control ever wants to hear. For once that dread alert is sounded, everything moves with controlled pandemonium. I'll return shortly with Act Two. In the air, secure on automatic pilot, the big DC-9 is a symbol of man's ability to conquer a hostile medium, to make it his own, as safely and sure as any bird. Inside this big bird, from the cockpit aft, the passengers have no notion of what lies ahead, as yet. But on the ground, if the Mayday alert has gotten through, Control Tower will be in charge. His voice calm but precise, but underlying it, the ragged edge of knowledge he shares with every pilot who receives. That man may conquer the elements, but never wholly subdue them.
Excuse me, Dr. McCall.
Yes, stewardess.
I'm sitting down beside you because I have no wish to alarm the rest of the plane. You are a medical doctor, aren't you?
If I'm not, I've kept up the pretense successfully for more years than I'd care to say.
Do you have a doctor's bag with you by any chance?
Yes. I don't know why. Force of habit. Why do you ask?
There's some trouble in the cockpit. The pilot and the co-pilot seem to be in some sort of... Well, have some sort of food poisoning. Could we just walk up there casually?
We better get there fast.
Well, not too fast. There's a lady watching us who is, well, volatile, for want of a better word. I don't want to get the rest of the plane alarmed. Tell you what, I left the cabin door open. I'll keep her busy while you go forward.
Whatever you say, my dear. Are they conscious?
I don't know. The captain was when I left. Don't worry. The plane's on automatic pilot. Well, Mrs. Miller, did you enjoy your stinger? Perhaps you'd like a repeat?
The scene in the control room of the plane is enough to turn anyone's blood to water. In the co-pilot seat, Doug Fletcher is half slumped to the floor, out cold. In the pilot seat to the left, Captain Thomas is valiantly trying to fight off his blackout, but only half conscious himself.
Flight 113 is rare. Sea rescue. Do you read? Do you read?
I'm a doctor, Captain.
Oh.
What's the trouble?
Oh, pain in the stomach. I want to throw up, but I can't. See, double. I can't keep my eyelids from closing.
All right, let's have a look.
No.
Same with your co-pilot?
Yes.
Did you eat together before you left on this flight?
No, but both had the same pie in Miami. Place called Aunt Vivi's. Pumpkin chiffon.
That doesn't sound so lethal.
Oh, I'm afraid.
How are they, Doctor?
What's your name again?
Fran.
Okay, Fran. I got got to make a snap diagnosis on damn little information. Looks like we have a couple of cases of botulism.
What's that?
That's kind of food poisoning that affects the nervous system. Both of them are in coma. Now, there's some toxins that might be helpful, but I don't have them in my bag. Best we're going to do is get plenty of cold towels and hope that we can bring one of them out of it.
And if we don't?
We are in real trouble. Any idea of our ETA?
Well, about midnight, Seattle time.
That's about an hour and a half?
Just about.
Well, first thing is to try to save these boys. Can you call back on the intercom to one of the other hostesses and get some ice and plenty of towels?
Yes, sir.
First, help me move the captain onto the floor.
This is Inez. What you want, Control?
Take a deep breath, hon.
You sound like it's bad enough news for me to pass clear out.
It isn't good, but I'm counting on you.
You put it that way, Fran. You can count.
Well, we have mucho trouble up front, but we don't want to get the passengers panicked.
Sure, but, you, what goes?
We need all the ice and towels we can get up front. Use the drink cart as a cover and come through as fast as you can.
Muy bien, querida. Leave it to Inez.
All right, baby?
I'm fine. Why, Fred?
I don't know. You seem to be sort of squirming around.
That isn't me. It's your firstborn.
Here comes the hostess with the cart now. You want some milk or something?
Your son and heir may be active, but he's not quite ready for that yet.
What? What?
Milk.
Oh, I don't know, Jackie. I get the notion you're working me over. Maybe we shouldn't have taken this trip.
Why not?
Because you resent it. I just thought, you know, a first baby and all, you'd be safer in Seattle with Mom and then all alone in Kansas City.
I wasn't exactly alone there.
Well, you didn't have any kinfolk to help out.
Did it ever occur to you I'd just like to have my baby by myself?
Well, it's my baby, too.
Sure it is. You've just got to excuse us uptight females at the end of the pregnancy route. We forget it's anything but just us and Junior.
You're the only two that count. And you first.
Cheer up, honey. Everything's going to be all right. I was thinking about something cold to drink, but we missed the boat. Or I should say cart. Inez is already all the way through to first class.
Look, I could go and get us...
No. It doesn't matter.
So, I'll catch her on the way back.
Who is it?
Inez with the towels and ice.
Just a minute.
Let me in quick. Big Nose there is smelling trouble.
Who?
The lady with the stingers.
Oh, she doesn't matter. Help me and the doctor get some cold towels on the captain and Doug.
They are passed out?
Oh, I hope that's all.
Then who is flying the plane?
That's a good question.
It's no use, girls. They're in deep coma.
Can't you bring them out of it?
I doubt it. If we get them hospitalized, if then...
They are not going to die.
From food poisoning? Botulism? That may be academic, though, unless we figure out some way to land this plane. Either of you pilots?
No.
Not me.
Are we deadheading any back there?
No.
Check the manifest?
I have it right here. None of our pilots.
Anyone on the list who flies?
I doubt it.
Oh. That leaves me.
You're a pilot?
In a manner of speaking. Before my wife died, when we lived in Wenatchee, I used to share a beat-up old Cherokee one-prop plane with another doctor. Only way to get to patients in outlying areas. I guess that's what got Pete all strung out on flying. Oh, that was small potatoes, though. It's over 6 years since I touched the controls. What can I do with this?
Somebody's got to do something. Not only to save the captain and Doug's lives, but 34 more of us, including you.
Well, what do we got to lose? You keep those cold towels on the captain on the floor. We'll leave the co-pilot in his seat to save room. Oh, this maze. The forest primeval. All right, give me the headphones. Where's radio in this mess?
Right here, Doctor. But they were having trouble with the regular frequencies.
What's it set on now?
I don't know. Army, air rescue, emergency maybe.
So, let's see what we can raise. Hello? Hello, anyone? Can you call me? Can you hear me?
We are receiving. Identify yourself, please.
Oh, sure. This is Dr. Sam McCall.
We are awaiting identification.
I just told you this is... I guess I have to remember to press down the button on the wheel for you to hear me, huh?
We can hear your reply.
What did you say? Wait a minute. What did you say?
Let go of the button.
Oh.
To explain to you that to receive us, you must release the red button on the wheel. And to transmit, you must press it down. Over to you.
I get it.
Then will you identify?
Sure. I'm Dr. Sam McCall.
Pete McCall's father?
You know my son?
Very well. But that doesn't matter for the moment. Will you identify your aircraft?
Oh, yes. This is flight... what's the number?
113 Transways Airlines. Inez, you hang in here. I'm going back to check the passengers.
Flight 113 Transways Airlines.
Oh, yes. You're the Mayday.
That's us, brother.
Well, can you give us your position?
Well, I can try, but with this maze of instruments, I'm not familiar with them.
Where are your pilots?
Both in a coma. Botulism poisoning.
Any chance they'll be out of it within the next hour and a half?
Hard to tell. I'd say kind of doubtful. They both were hit so bad, it's a toss-up whether they can hold out against respiratory paralysis.
And there's no other qualified commercial pilot aboard?
That's right. The only guy ever flew anything is me. And then it was just a little old one-lung Cherokee prop you flew by the seat of your pants.
Well, if you can fly a Cherokee, you can fly a DC-9.
You're going to have to teach me, brother. And I sure hope you can in the next hour and a half. Because if you don't tell me how to bring her down, I guess we're just going to head out over the Pacific till we run out of gas and drop into the sea.
A situation to challenge the worst nightmare you ever dreamed. Behind him are over 30 people depending on him for their lives. Facing him is a mass of instruments, dials, switches, buttons, and levers, most of them unfamiliar to him, which control the 100-plus tons of airplane that he must put down on the ground safely within a short span of 90 minutes. I shall return as soon as I can with Act 3. In the cockpit of a four-engine jet monster 31,000 feet above the ground, alone. A 65-year-old man who joined this flight with nothing but death on his mind. Dr. Sam McCall, widower, now flying to pick up the coffin and the body of his pilot son, who died tragically in a crash on Guam. Now, suddenly, by a massive wrench of fate, he is thrown back into the stream of life because he is the only person aboard who can fly this plane. And landing it safely depends on the quiet voice in his headphones.
Now, did you locate the altimeter?
Yeah, I have it.
What does it read?
3010.
Good, good. Now, you're at 31,000, and that is your altitude until further instructions. Look at the instrument panel.
I hate to. It scares the hell out of me. There's the bank and turn indicator. And this looks like it could be the airspeed indicator.
So just take it easy, Doc. You've got this thing licked. You know enough about it. Okay, Doc?
Confirm. Hey, I like the Doc part, too. Something about having a name makes me feel more at home. Do I get one for you?
Affirmative. This is Colonel Blake.
Okay, Colonel, we'll use our titles. Now, how do I fly this crate?
It's a breeze, Doc. You just look down, and you'll see the rudder pedals. Put your feet on them. Now, Look for your airspeed indicator and get familiar with it. That's the one left of the two circles dead ahead.
Yeah, I got it.
And now above that is your climb and dive indicator.
I see it.
Now, directly to your right are stabilizer and trim levers. Now, you come to your throttles. They should be set at cruising speed. What is your airspeed indicator read?
485.
Roger. That's right where she should be. Now, the pedestal, those are the yellow throttles. The forward increases your speed. Check?
Check. Back decreases, right?
Right, right. But they must be coordinated and gentle. Now, do you locate the automatic pilot switch? It's up there on the console, over your head, to the right slightly.
Yeah, I have it, Colonel.
Now, you are ready to fly the plane, Doc.
I hope.
No sweat. Now, you've flown before. This baby's just a little bit bigger. Now, hands on the wheel, feet on the rudders. Reach forward and flip off automatic.
Check. What? She lurched on.
No, that's to be expected. You now have control of the aircraft. Keep her just as she is. Watch your climb and dive indicator. Watch your airspeed. Hold it steady. How's she coming?
Brother, what a difference. I can feel every ton of her. Sluggish. Heavy.
Don't let her fool you. Sure, she feels different from a Cherokee, but remember, Doc, all controls are on servo mechanism. They react, you know, from the slightest touch. They're like power controls in a car. Now, we're going to let you feel that out. Very, very gently, we're going to have you descend a little. Okay, Doc?
You're the boss, Colonel.
Just as you take over. So, grip the four knobs in the center. We're going to ease up on the throttle. Not so fast. Easy. Ease it off. You notice it's getting quiet. Now, easy. Push forward slowly on the wheel.
Boy, she responds quick.
Pull back. Now, ease forward again. You notice she's going quiet?
Yeah. I don't like it.
That's the way she goes. Now, push forward on the wheel. Easy.
Hey, she's getting away from me. Took it right out of my hand.
But slow.
Yeah, I am, but she's bucking like a steer.
You're overcorrecting. Easy does it. Remember, Doc, it's just a touch. The servo mechanism does all the rest. Now, bring your nose down.
Wilco.
That's a comforting old word.
It's all scary. Real scary. I don't know if I can make it.
You can cut it, Doc. As soon as we get you up top again, we're going to try banking left and right a little, just so you have the plane well in hand.
What is it, Jackie, baby? A baby.
I'm afraid. Yes, it's so near. The pain's almost every minute.
Oh, Lord. What are we going to do?
I'll try to hold on. Honest, I will, but...
Stewardess, friend, it's Jackie, my wife. She's having the baby.
Here, help me get these seat backs down in front. Stretch her out. I'll get blankets.
Inez?
Yes, Glenn. Get up to the cockpit and tell Doctor Mrs. Pierce's baby is coming. I'll do my best to handle it. I'll try not to bother him, but I might have to call for instructions on the intercom.
Sure, Fred, sure.
So get going. Ladies and gentlemen, listen to me, please. There is no reason for panic. The plane is in good hands. I want to get all of us as far back towards the tail as we can. Everyone find their life jackets and inflate them, as instructed when we were taking off. We have a lady who is about to deliver her child. I'm asking you to the rear as much for her privacy as for any other reason. We are all going to be all right.
if the good Lord grants us a new somebody into the world, he sure doesn't plan to take all the rest of us out of it.
Excuse me, Doctor. How's it going?
Not so bad now. Back on automatic. Taking a little rest. How's everything back there?
Oh, not bad. Not good. I mean, Fran, she asked me to tell you she is handling it, but she might have to call by the intercom in case because there's a lady having a baby.
Oh, that's nice. I'll try to set it down easy as I can. When is it due?
I don't know exactly when, but it's on the way right now.
In the midst of death, we are in life. Or is it the other way around? Does Fran know what to do?
I don't know. She said she would do her best, but...
What's that?
Intercom. You throw this switch here.
Oh. Hello?
Hello, Doctor. It's Fran. Everything okay up there?
For the moment.
I'm sorry to bother you, but I have a problem.
The lady who's giving birth?
Yes. The baby is coming, but it's positioned the wrong way.
Breech birth. Look, you can't handle that. I tell you what, we have an odd 25 minutes to play around with. Hold everything. I'll be right back. Flight 113 to control.
I am receiving you.
How much time do I have before we start descent approach?
25, 30 minutes.
All right, then hang on till I get back to you. Before I try to land this plane, I got to do something I really know about. I've got to go deliver a baby. This is flight 113, my term, to control.
We have you, Doc. How's the baby?
A fine boy. Kind of makes up a little for my own. How do we stand?
You're ready to get off automatic and commence descent. At 485 knots, you should be coming down at 1,500 feet per minute.
Roger. I'm now commencing descent.
Very good. Now, hold that descent rate to 1,800 feet a minute, and then we'll go into landing approach.
Funny thing, Colonel.
What? What's that, Doc?
I just accomplished something very difficult. Bringing one life into the world. I hope I'm as successful in keeping 37 lives protected that are already here.
Coming in on your final approach. The descent is fine. How do you feel?
Oh, I'm okay. Going a little fast, but... Okay.
All right. Now, we lower the wheels. You remember the exercise?
Affirm. Pull out rear lever and push down. Watch for three green lights indicating wheels down. Have the green.
Okay, the landing gear is down. We have you in sight. Now give her some throttle as the gear slows you down.
I feel the drag. More throttle?
Now watch the flap indicator. You remember?
Yeah, I remember. 10 degrees of flaps added. Confirmed.
Roger. Hold her there. Now maintain airspeed at 127.
I'm maintaining speed.
You're doing fine. Keep your feet on the pedals. Keep her nice and level. Can you see the runway?
I see it.
All right. Now maintain all configurations. You're doing just fine, Doc. Just fine. We like the picture. Come in, easy as you are.
I'm getting awful close.
Just keep your nose up. Watch the airspeed.
Yeah. It's dropped 10, 20.
Now that's all right. You know you're slowing her up. And you're in, so hit your brakes. And drop your nose.
Confirmed. Hey, she's yawing.
Hold your rudder. Firm. Hold your attitude. Keep that yoke back. Hard back. Keep that yoke back. Push hard on those brakes, Doc. Push hard.
Should I reverse engine?
No. Steady on the rudder pedals. Keep that nose down. Give it all you have on the brakes.
I made it.
That's all your son asked for. Signing off.
And in the operations office of the airport, the hero of the hour has been sequestered in blessed relief from all the hoopla and excitement by the airport director.
Anything I can get you? A drink or something, Doctor?
A bed, mainly. First, though, I've got some thank yous to dispense. Was it you who talked me down?
I don't understand.
Well, somebody on ground communications landed that big crate without damage. Not me. Who was on the horn with me all the way in?
Well, nobody.
What do you mean, nobody? I was talking to myself?
All I mean is that out of Kansas City, everyone lost contact with Flight 113. As far as we're concerned, on the ground, only one man set her down. Dr. Sam McCall.
Yeah, but that's crazy. Colonel Blake was the one who monitored every move I made. If it wasn't for him, me, and everyone aboard, including the new young man, would have been gone geese. I couldn't have landed that skyscraper by myself.
You say, you were in radio contact all the way?
Well, sure, with Colonel Blake.
Colonel Jackson Blake?
I never did get his first name. Well, why? You know him?
But no, not personally, but... Well, he was the pilot of the plane in which your son crashed and all personnel were lost.
He said he knew my son, Pete. You trying to say he was dead all the time?
Well, the only thing I know is that right beside your son Pete's coffin is one that contains a Colonel Blake. And your radio was out cold. But no one else could have talked you down.
What can you add to that? An elderly man who hadn't touched a plane control in 6 years, and then only a single engine, landed several tons of modern multi-engine jet by himself in radio silence. Or was there some other force beyond that which brought him home? You make up your minds. I'll be back shortly. Vouch for the story you just heard. It's part and parcel of many legends. There was a whole crew who got poisoned eating key lime pie. There is a story of the radio operator of a sunken aircraft carrier who talked a plane home. Tale of a dead son who brought his father down, and so on and so on. All we ask on this program is not belief, just suspension of disbelief. Our cast included Robert Dryden, Jennifer Harmon, Earl Hammond, Richard Seff, and Hetty Galen. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. Radio Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by Buick Motor Division and by the Florida Orange Growers. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.